And Ms. Hawkins? With the corrections. All right, thank you, Ms. Hawkins. And I thought I saw another hand on the last row. No, I was mistaken.
I didn't realize attorneys counted, but my sister-in-law is an attorney.
Okay, great. Okay, all right, thank you, Ms. McKay. Okay, the if you all would just bear with me just a second, and Your Honor and counsel, I just want to talk about some frustration that I had.
Now, Mr. Price, you've got to ask a question.
I am going to ask a question, Judge.
Okay. How long is the preamble?
The preamble is 30 seconds.
That's too long.
Okay, 15 seconds.
We better get down to 10.
Okay, 10 seconds. I was involved in a motor vehicle accident earlier this week and became very, very frustrated with something that the police officer did. How many of you all have ever felt some level of frustration with a police officer? How many of you all? Okay, and I'm gonna start. Let's see, I see Mr. Scott, and I saw another hand on the third row. Is it Nowak?
Nowak.
Now, without telling us what that frustration was, Mr. Scott and Mr. Nowak, some of the evidence that you're going to hear in this case is going to be testimony from police officers and testimony from the police officers, okay? Does that frustration, whatever it was, would it in any way influence your ability to sit and impartially listen to the evidence and the testimony that's been offered here today without holding anything against the police officer based on that frustration? Mr. Nowak? It would not. How about you, Mr. Scott?
No.
Okay. Right, and my last set of questions is, I don't think it's very personal, but I'm gonna ask it. How many of you all drive? Okay, everybody drives. For those of you who operate a motor vehicle, how many of you all have a bumper sticker on? Any of you all have a bumper? No, nobody has a bumper sticker? Okay. All right. That's all the questions I have, Your Honor.
All right,
thank you.
All right, for the defense, Mr. Stegmaier.
Thank you, Your Honor. Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Like I said, my name's Ian Stegmaier. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Masters Mr. Price for getting everybody warmed up and talking and everything like that. It's good to get over that hump of nervousness that we all may have, a level of comfort with each other. We all touched on people we know in this case, okay? And nobody knows Mr. Shore, and nobody knows John, nobody knows anybody over here had any interactions. Did any of these policemen ever write anyone a ticket, anything like that? Okay. Sometimes the wheels start turning as the trial goes through. I want everyone to think about it. And on that same note, I was a policeman for a while, too. I ever written anybody a ticket? No. Okay, good. Just so we get that out of the way. We touched on the difference between a criminal trial and a civil trial. And Mr. Scott, do you remember what the burden was in that civil trial, the burden of proof? Did they talk about burden of proof at all?
Yeah, I mean, it was just there was just, you know, complaints and that it was a lot of discrimination towards, you know, black person.
Okay.
And he didn't really have any evidence showing, or he didn't file any complaints. Nothing was on file, nothing was said. But there was stuff that happened there that was hostile and, you know, bad work environment. But that guy got to keep his job after doing the incident twice.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So
sure.
That's where I kind of felt like, you know, he should have lost his job and the other guy should have lost his job.
Okay. So you didn't necessarily think that somebody met their burden of proof. Is that
right?
A fair statement?
Right.
Okay. Ms. Callahan, you were recently involved on a jury in a civil trial as well?
I was called to a criminal jury.
jury when it settled.
Okay.
Before we even got to hear.
Okay. And was it Ms. Hawkins? You were on the same jury as Mr. Scott. Did you talk about what the burden of proof was in that trial?
Just basically what he said.
Okay. Did they talk about a preponderance of the evidence that they had to make their case?
They did. I mean, like he said, they didn't show
okay.
Okay.
Well, what I'm getting at is there is a difference in the justice system on burdens of proof, depending on what kind of action there is. Okay, the different burdens of proof, if you will, we start out with a scintilla of evidence, with just a tiny speck of evidence, okay? Then comes reasonable, articulable suspicion, and that's basically what a policeman might need to search your car if he had a reason to stop you on a traffic stop. Then comes probable cause. Probable cause is what they need to arrest you. Okay, that's where the arrest comes in. And you know, we're getting closer when you look at the justice scales. Okay? Now, what you need in a civil trial is a preponderance of the evidence, which is a slight tip of the scale, and they have to prove that their case by a preponderance of the evidence. Basically 51% wins. Okay, then as you go up the scale, you would get to clear and convincing evidence, and we're getting even higher, okay? Now, the highest burden, and I don't think I'm allowed to talk to you exactly about what it is, but the highest burden is proof beyond a reasonable doubt. And proof beyond a reasonable doubt is the Commonwealth's burden. That's what they need for you to find John guilty, if that's what you choose to do, okay? Now, it is their burden. We don't have to prove anything. And does anybody, who thinks that's fair, that we don't have to prove something? Okay, well, raise your hand if you don't think it's fair. Okay.
I think it's not fair. You should have to prove your point, you know,
okay.
Understand of why you feel like he's not guilty.
Okay, fair enough. Now, does anyone know why we don't have to prove that he's not guilty? We're innocent until proven guilty. Very good. That's the concept, right? Anyone here in a science field or know any scientists or say take a science class? How hard is it to prove a negative? You can't prove a negative, right? It's impossible. You cannot prove a negative. So that's why we don't have to prove anything. We don't have to prove he's not guilty. That's why he's innocent until they prove him guilty. So let me ask you for a second to make my point again. Who here thinks he's, and I'll get to it a little quicker than before. Who thinks he's guilty right now? Who thinks he's innocent? Oh, I hope everyone would raise their hand, because right now, he is. That's my trick question I throw in there. Right now, he is innocent, and that's definitely the point that I'm trying to make for everybody. Okay, we talked about some people who are related to law enforcement, or anyone here have a close friend who's a law enforcement officer? Anyone at all? Okay.
And so I know several police officers because they're in our store.
They would come in for shoplifting security. Complaints and things
like
that?
Security.
Do off-duty security?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And
I was there 17 years, so I got to know a lot of them pretty well.
Okay. Okay, fair enough. Yes?
My husband's retired from the Metro Police Department, but he was a civilian. He wasn't an officer. He worked in the photo lab.
Okay.
But he's been retired since 08.
Okay. And let's see, Ms. Evans, you had your hand up.
I forgot, he mentioned earlier, my husband's cousin was a Metro police officer, but he got moved up to a
detective?
Detective, an art detective.
Okay. They're still a police officer, but that's like a promotion or a pretty cool lateral move, okay? Absolutely, absolutely. And Ms. Hawkins, you stated that your was it your sister that's a sergeant?
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct? At a correctional facility? Is that accurate? Okay.
And her husband,
they both are. Okay. They ever tell any stories
mm-hmm.
about what happens in the jail or? No, fair enough. I'm not going to ask anyone to relate any of the stories. I know how they go. Do they relate, ma'am, do they relate stories to you as well at Dillard's?
Yeah, one of the police officers that we had in the store, like I said, I've been there 17 years, so I've known this person for a long time, and he ended up having a cast on his hand.
Oh, had someone that you know that's a police officer?
I've got many. I know many police officers.
Okay.
Friends and my colleagues.
Okay. Now, those of you who do know police officers, family, friends, or whatnot, and those of you who don't, please feel free to chime in as well, because I want your opinions too. Who thinks that, does anybody here think that police have magical powers, or that they should just be able to do whatever they want?
Oh, yeah.
No, wait a minute now.
You think they should be able to?
He wants to know if you believe they have magical powers. Do you believe they have magical powers?
Okay.
They got magical powers.
Do you think
they got, like authority over everything, you know what I'm saying?
And that's important, isn't it? Because if we don't have police officers that have given authority, then we could have anarchy. Is that a fair statement of what you believe in? Someone else over here raised their hand, too. Yes.
Well, I kind of got that, you know, I feel that way sometimes when I'm on the road and they're flying by me going 100 miles an hour without a light on. It's like, but if I did that, I'd probably get a ticket. I have said that. So.
But to be fair, they may be going to an emergency and need to turn the lights off for a reason, right? Yeah.
I mean, I'm not bad mouthing them at all.
Sure.
We could live without them.
Absolutely.
She just reminded me of something when she said that.
Okay.
Driving.
Okay. Now, my point isn't to sit here and police that by any means, okay? Let's not get into that. But what I'm saying is, and you guys bring up some good points, okay? You have a great point. We need them to have authority, right? But you guys also bring a point. With that authority comes great responsibility, correct? And who here thinks that they should have to follow certain limits in their authority as well? Does everybody agree? If you don't, please raise their hand. Okay, so we're all on the same page as far as that goes. You know what? I think that's all the questions I have for everybody. You guys have been very patient, and it is a Friday afternoon, so we'll try and get you out of here real quick. Thank you for your time.
All right. Again, now, ladies and gentlemen, having been asked all these questions by Mr. Price and Mr. Stegmeier, I need to know if there's any of you all can think of any reason that you believe that you would find it difficult to be fair and impartial to both the Commonwealth and Mr. Masters, and sit as a juror in this case. Okay. Now, it's going to take us, we have to select a jury. I need to advise you that all of you all should not form any opinion about this case with the little you know about it. And that you're not to discuss the case among yourselves. You're not to allow anybody to approach you and attempt to discuss the case. And should anybody attempt to discuss the case with you, you need to notify Deputy Weathers here. Now, in this court, we're going to select 7 jurors today, 6 and an alternate. And if you're selected, you will be able to have something to drink. And there's a concession stand right to your right as you go out the door. So we're going to take about, 10 minutes. So I need for you all to assemble on Deputy Weathers here, you know, a little bit after 2, and then we can get moving from there. All right?
All right, so the jury.
Lawyers, I need to know if you all have a, are there any challenges for cause?
We don't have any challenges for cause, Your Honor.
Mr. Price?
We don't have any, Judge.
All right, now, what I'm going to have to do is, let's see here, and I got to make, this is the most critical part. Each of you are going to get 4 strikes. Our 4 strikes, and that's 8 and means we got I got to draw 5, so I'm going to draw 5 random, right? I'm going to draw 5 random. Actually, Reuben is. And once we get those 5 will be
stricken as random. So then you know the 15 we have left, each of you get four.